screen up here, and let's sing This Is the Day.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made, we will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day.
Turn over to him 191, and let's sing, I Know That My Redeemer Liveth.
I know that my Redeemer liveth, and on the earth again shall stand. I know eternal
of the Lord and to worship him, to give him praise and honor this morning. We thank the Lord for your presence here. If you're visiting with us, there's a visitor's card in the back of the pew. Please do us the honor of filling that out and dropping an offering plate a little later, or hand it to one of us on the way out. We're so glad that you've come this way to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. Let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer. There are many on our prayer list, but we especially want to remember these in prayer this morning: Brenda Sapp, also Joyce Boyette, Brother Cliff Easterling, and remember Tommy and Gail Osteen. Tommy did get moved to Bayview, and we continue to pray for his rehab. Also lift up Pam Dowling. She'll be having surgery this week. And Brother John Stevens, as he continues to improve, and he'll be going to Riverside in Waycross for rehab there. So we continue to pray for him and lift him to the Lord in prayer. Also ask you to remember our Sunday school and pray for our stocking ministry as we prepare. Our goal is 10,000 stockings. We have 7,000 stockings made, not filled, but the stockings are made. And if you'd like to sew and make stockings, that'll be a good thing. Help us reach that goal of 10,000. And then, of course, we're going to have things to put in them. But we want to pray for that. Pray because each one is an outreach, and each one shares the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Pray for our Sunday school that we'll reach out and invite people to come and be a part of God's family. Let's pray as we go to the Lord. Father, how we thank you for the privilege of prayer, for the joy of praying and seeking the face of Christ. I ask this morning that if there's one here in this room who has never accepted you, that they would come today and receive Jesus Christ as their Lord and their Savior. I pray for those who need to join this church, that they would know the doors of this church are open to welcome them and receive them. I pray for all of we as Christians that, God, where we need to draw closer to you, we would make our way to this altar. We would pray and seek your face and call upon your name, that we might ever draw closer and closer to you. We pray for our military, our missionaries around the world. We pray for these who are sick and suffering, for these who have experienced sorrow this week. And Lord, we lift up every need of each and every individual here. May we leave here today saying it was good to have been in the house of the Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Thank you. You may be seated. The announcements have been scrolling on the screen. Those you are aware of, we just want to remind you that we are collecting candy and so forth out here in the hallway for the Fall Festival, which will be on the 18th of October. And we encourage you to bring bags of candy and so forth so we'll have ample supply for that. Also, I want to remind those on the church council, we will meet Thursday evening at 7 o'clock. And so we encourage you to be there for that meeting. Other announcements are in our bulletin, but I wonder if there's anything special that anyone has they want to announce at this time. All right. Now then, let's continue to praise the Lord in song as we come before him.
If you will now take your hymnals and turn to 273, Freely, Freely. Let's stand as we sing together, please.
God forgave my sin in Jesus' name. I've been born again in Jesus' name. And in Jesus' name I come to you to share his love as he told me to.
Bible says, freely the Lord has given. And what a record for us that we may freely give in the name of Christ our Savior. We come to ask God's blessing upon this offering. Let us bow our heads, and one of our men shall lead us as we pray.
Heavenly Father, ask your grace and mercy upon us. Forgive our sins, Lord, we live before you. We just ask your spirit be in this place today. God, just lift up again. Lift him up, Lord, and just deliver the message you've laid on his heart. Yeah. God, hearts receive the Lord, minds to understand, Father God. We just thank you, praise you, and all the things you do for us, Lord. May there be somebody here today, Lord, that needs that same power that you have, Father God. They come to know you today, Lord, sir. And that blessed hope that you are. We just thank you, praise you, ask to protect these monies we're about to receive, and may they be used wisely in the furtherance of your kingdom, Father God. We just give you the great the praise and the glory that you deserve. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. May be seated.
The choir had a special this morning, but Ellen got called away. Her daughter-in-law got sick, so she had to do the bad job of going looking after that new grandbaby and rocking her so that the mama would be looked after. So it's a bad job, but somebody's got to do it, and us grandmamas like to do that. So keep them in your prayers, and Rodney is going to come and share with us special music this morning.
In myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard. you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty. Be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. In the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise, all that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet, hear your voice, word of God speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty. Be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty. Be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay.
Well, boys and girls, grades 1 through 3. Miss Amanda's ready for children's church, so that'll be good. Any others? Go with her. There you go. You have your Bibles, turn to Matthew chapter 24 as we look to the word of the Lord and tribulation truths as we share God's word together here this morning. Matthew chapter 24. As we well know, as we look to God's word, we finished the book of Revelation, and now we're coming back in sort of a capsule of Matthew chapter 24 and 25, and we're going to look at these chapters together as we share the word of the Lord. Let's stand out of respect to God's word. We're going to begin reading Matthew 24, verse 15. Matthew 24, verse 15. When you therefore shall see the abomination of desolation. You want to underline those words right there, the abomination of desolation, because there'll be something special we say about that. Spoken of by Daniel the prophet. Stand in the holy place, whoso readeth, let him understand. Then let them which are in Judea flee unto the mountains. Let him which is on the housetop not come down to take anything out of his house. Neither let him which is in the field return back to get his clothes. And woe unto them that are with children, that are nursing those children in that day. Pray that your flight is not in the winter, neither on the Sabbath day. For then shall be great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world or ever shall be. And except those days should be shortened, there should no flesh be saved, but for the elect's sake, and those days shall be shortened. Father, bless your word. We thank you for it. Open our minds to receive it, our hearts to believe it, our lives to live it out. And we thank you for your Holy Spirit. And I pray that when we leave here, we will say it was good to have been in the house of the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Thank you. You may be seated. And we say there are some things that are difficult to understand in the truth of the Scripture. But these words are pretty clear because they lay before us the foundation of the things that are beginning to happen right now in the day and age in which you and I live. Oftentimes when we come to church, we look over the Word, and we see, and we sort of may leave with questions. It's kind of, I told him this morning, like a little boy that went to his first wedding. He'd never been to a wedding. And he watched everything that happened. He looked at it closely, observed it well. And as the preacher stood up there and he said, for this is one woman, for this one man, for all time, and let that which God had joined together, no man put asunder. And he was drinking all that in. And so they were riding home, and the daddy said to him, said, son, I saw you really watching that wedding. He said, yeah. He said, well, how many wives is that man supposed to have? The boy thought a minute. He said, 16. He said, 16? He said, yeah, didn't you hear the preacher? Four for the better, four for the worse, four for richer, and four for poorer. So that makes 16, right? Well, some may feel that way, amen. When you look at Matthew chapter 24, what you're seeing is a message that is given to us in these last days, because all true believers will be caught up before the tribulation ever begins. But we're going to suffer some of these pains that are going to happen. In other words, we're going to experience the tremors, and we're going to experience some of the shocks, but we won't experience the full tribulation, because we all know the verse that the Lord himself, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, the trumpet of God shall sound. Those who've died as Christians will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. Revelation chapter 4, verse 1 says, come up hither, and I'll show you the things which must be hereafter. So after being caught up, which is the word for rapture, then the earth is going to be plunged into great tribulation. As the writer says here, Matthew writes, and Jesus is speaking, and out beside these verses, you need to write the words Jesus is speaking, because this is what he says, not what some apostle says or disciple says or preacher says. This is what Jesus says. But we know that because we're saved by the blood of Jesus, we won't have to go through the tribulation. Amen? But we'll be free from that. If you know Jesus as your Savior, now if you don't know him and you've never accepted him, there's not much hope I can give you until you do receive him. Because all who do not accept Christ will be left behind to go through this great tribulation that he's talking about. Well, how do I know that we're already experiencing some of the things that are going on? Well, in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 7, it says, the spirit of iniquity does already work. In other words, it's already taking place. None of you in this room ever dreamed that you'd see some of the things that are happening right now in this day and age. Nobody ever thought that if you worked in a church among children, you'd have to have a background check in order to be able to work with those children. We never dreamed that it'd come a time when we had to have security or law officers present on a school campus to protect the kids that are there. We never one time dreamed that there would come a time when there was any kind of debate about some older person who was very sick, and they decided that they'd just put them to sleep because they were no more use to society and could no longer function in society, and to get them off the Medicare and Medicaid rolls and move on. We never dreamed that there'd be a time when there would be abortion on demand, when millions of little babies would be murdered before they were ever born. That's what abortion is. And it had become convenient for the society, and we have the shed blood of innocence on our hands in America today. We never thought that would happen. Why is all that taking place? Because it is a precursor, it is a forerunner to what the Antichrist is going to do when he rules and he reigns upon planet Earth. All that will characterize a tribulation is coming into focus now. And we can see that all around us. I want you to turn to the right in your Bible and turn over until you get to 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy in chapter 3. And I just want to read these seven verses. You need to mark them in your Bible. 2 Timothy chapter 3, as we read the word of the Lord. 2 Timothy chapter 3. You need to mark these well. The Bible says in 2 Timothy chapter 3, beginning verse 1, this know that in the last days perilous times shall come. Watch this. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, they can't control themselves, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. For of this sort are they which creep into houses and lead captivity silly women laden with sins and led away with diverse lusts, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of truth. So when you come back over here to Matthew chapter 24 and 25, it characterizes the tribulation, but in 2 Timothy chapter 3, he says this is what's leading up to the tribulation. Without natural affection, truce breakers, heady, high-minded, unholy, unthankful, disobedient to parents. Never has there been a day and age when there is much rebellion going on as in the day and age in which you and I live. Never is a day when men have given over to pleasure more than lovers of God, and they've established gods in their own right. Chapter 24 and 25, back over here in Matthew, is written mainly for the Jew, but it contains a great message for the church in the last days, because it shows us these things are going to happen. And tonight you come to church, you're going to be astounded at some of the things that pretend to be godlike and are not, as we share about the Christ impersonators tonight. But here in this passage in Matthew, let's look quickly, because this is Jesus who is speaking. And Jesus is saying to us things that we need to hear. First of all, he says to us the Jewish world will be smitten by the preceding power of the Antichrist. Look in verse 15. When you therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place. Whosoever readeth, let him understand. Now underline the word abomination of desolation, because it is prophesied in the book of Daniel, and it simply means this. First of all, abomination. Now when the Antichrist gets control of the world, he is going to rise up as a man of peace and a man of power. I told you the other day that in the Middle East they're saying maybe some leader will arise who will be able to pull all these nations together and bring peace to the Middle East. And maybe someone will come up who will be able to have a plan for Israel and the Arabs and make it all right. Well, there will be. His name is the Antichrist. He's going to rule, and he's going to dupe all of those people into following him, and he's going to get Israel to follow him, because he's going to bring peace to the Middle East. But he's going to do something else. It is called an abomination of desolation. He is going to put his image, a statue of himself, inside the temple. And he's going to command that people bow down and worship that image of the Antichrist. Now, every Jew from the time that they're born are taught never to worship any graven image. Remember the first commandment? Thou shalt have no other gods before you. I, thy God, am a jealous God. You shall not have graven images, and so on and so on. So they all know. And when they realize that he has done this, they will immediately know that he is not the Messiah that they're looking for, that he's a fake and a phony, and they're going to have to get out of there, because he's going to exercise power to kill them and to destroy them. That's called abomination, because he sets up this idol of himself. But it is called a desolation because he desecrates the temple of God by putting a false idol in the middle of that temple. And it is going to desecrate the very temple of God there in Jerusalem. Well, now let's back up a minute and come to 2014. We do not have a specified temple as they will in Jerusalem. But I ask you today, where is the temple of God for every believer in Christ Jesus? The Bible says that we have become the temple of God. Now listen close. If you've got something in your heart or in your life that's taking precedence over God, something that you love more than God, that you're more obsessed with than God, something that you're more sold out to than God, then there is an abomination of desolation that's occurring in your temple, in your heart, and in your life today. It can be anything. You can fill in the blank. It can be hunting. It can be fishing. It can be golf. It can be sports. It can be recreation. It can be anything that you want to name. It can even be family. Because the Bible says, he that does not love father, mother, sister, and brother, son, or daughter more than he loves me is not fit for the kingdom of God. Now that doesn't mean he says you're to do away with your family. That's not what he's talking about. But he is talking about the very fact that Jesus Christ must be first and he must be Lord of everything within our life. So it doesn't matter if it's houses, lands, money. It doesn't matter if it's hobbies. It doesn't matter what it is. Anything that takes precedent over following Christ has become a god that you set up in your temple and you're worshiping that and following that far greater and far more than you're following the living God. It can be anything. It doesn't have to be big. It doesn't have to be small. It can be anything. It can be your pride. It can be your desires. It can be what your plans are. If God is not first, and if he's not foremost in your heart and in your life, and if he has to take a back seat to whatever it is that you're worshiping, then I want you to know today you've set up an abomination of desolation in your temple, in your life. That is an awakening call to us in these last days. Is there anything, God, in my life that I am more subservient to and I am more in love with and more dedicated to than I am with you? If there is, then I've got a false idol in my life, because Jesus Christ is the only one. So he said they're going to experience this abomination of desolation. But in these last days, we're already experiencing that. We're experiencing it in our lives, in our hearts, and in our soul. And the Word of God plainly tells us, as you look at this passage of Scripture, that the Antichrist is going to raise his image to be worshipped, and false gods are going to dominate the Gentile world and the Jewish world. And these false gods are already in place. For many in Israel today, they don't believe in God. They went back, the Bible said it would happen. They've gone back as unbelievers and unbelievers in God. They don't even believe there is a God. And their God is the land of Israel, and their God is military power, and their God is economic wealth. Sounds just like America, doesn't it? And anything that replaces God in your life or supplants him has become a god. Doesn't matter what it is. It can be your vocation, your recreation. It can be the handiwork of your hands. It can be the desires of your heart. It can be the love of money, which is the root of all evil. It can be a thousand different things, but only you know what it is today. And only you can set it right with the power of God by coming to his altar and asking God to straighten those things out in your heart and in your life. You see, the second thing is that false religions will dominate the earth. And they're dominating the earth because man has decided that he indeed knows better than God knows. In fact, as you read about the end time, the Bible makes this one great statement. And it is so surreal for our day and age. The Bible says there will come a time when men will not endure sound doctrine. You know what that means? That means they don't want you to preach the Bible. They don't want you to preach the Word of God. They don't want to preach hell hot and hell long. They want you to give them something that's going to tickle the ears and some positive mental attitude strategy and something that says, oh, you're going to get a blessing and you're just going to be overwhelmed with the goodness. And so just build it by thousands who heap unto themselves teachers having itching ears. But listen, there's no more positive word in the world than the Bible. The Bible says I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. But the Bible also says, the soul that sinneth shall surely die. The Bible says that God desires to bless you, and he has plans to bless you and not to hurt you, and he has plans to do good unto you. But the Bible also says, whom the Lord loves, he chastises. You see, you can't preach a half gospel, and you can't preach a part Bible. When he says, I love you, we need to say, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. But we also need to preach the passage that says, for there is a sin, which is a sin unto death, and God will deal with those who commit that sin unto death. Now that's for the saved man. Lost man's already committed the sin unto death because he's never accepted Jesus Christ as his Savior. And he's standing in jeopardy all the day long because he has made up his own religion. That's as old, we've been studying in discipleship training in the book of Genesis, and that's as old as Cain. And there are those who defend Cain. In fact, there are some cults who have Cain as their hero. And God said, you're to bring the firstling of the flock, and the blood shall be shed, and your sins shall be forgiven, and the sacrifice will be made. And Cain said, well, I'm a farmer. I'm going to get me some grain, and the first grain of my flock, of my fields, I'm going to take the first of everything, and I'm going to take it to God, and I'm going to offer it to God. Amen. That's not what God said to do. You say, but he gave the first that he had. Yes, he did. He obeyed God in being there. Yes, he did. But he disobeyed God in doing it like God said instead of like Cain wanted to do. And you see, that's our problem today in the forerunner of the tribulation, because today people are doing it as they want to do instead of like God wants. They say, well, if I want to miss this Sunday, or if I want to be gone this week, or if I don't want to read my Bible, if I don't want to tithe, if I don't want to pray, if I don't want to join the church, if I don't want to witness, if I don't want to do those things, then I'm perfectly free to do so because I know the Lord. Well, friends, Cain knew the Lord. In fact, the Lord came to him personally and said to him, why is your countenance so sad? And then he asked him this question. He said, if thou doest not well, sin lieth at the door. That's what God said over in Genesis chapter 4. If thou doest not well, sin lieth at the door. My friend, let me tell you something. Have you ever thought about that the reason we face some of the bumps and gullies and rough places in our life is because sin lies at the door? We have made our own religion and designed our own fashion of worship. And we do like we want. We go as we like. We count God out. And we say, but, hey, I'm a believer. Cain was a believer. You see, in the last days, what I'm trying to say to you this morning is that this kind of philosophy will dominate the earth because it is a false religion and it is not a formed relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus himself said, you do err because you know not the Scripture. And it is surprising that in our churches today, in fundamental Bible-believing churches, Baptist churches, that we have got a majority of people who never open their Bible from one Sunday to the next and read it. They don't even know what the Bible says, and they don't try to read the Bible, and they don't study the Bible, though the Bible says, study to show thyself approved. They don't search the Word of God that they may know the heart of God, to do the will of God, in order to do the work of God. They don't do any of those things. So what is that? That's a false religion. That's something that makes us feel good because we want to feel good. And there's nothing wrong with that. Everybody likes to feel good. But when it is anti-scriptural, you miss the whole point of what God wants. We envelop ourselves in the mundane and the ordinary more than we envelop ourselves in the Word of God. And brother, when the Word of God is left out, we become weak and we become anemic. The Jewish world is smitten, but also the Gentile world, the church of the last days, is smitten by the error of Scripture. Secondly, he said the swiftness of events will leave no time for preparation. When you look at what's going to happen and people having to get out of Jerusalem and Judea and flee, the Bible says there will be a mass exodus from Jerusalem and Judea, and those people will leave to try to find safety. to try to find some place where there will be a harbinger for them of safety. Many years ago, Miss Van and I were a group, and we visited a place called Petra. If you have ever watched Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade, they showed the pictures of Petra, in which you saw the Treasury Building, which was that beautiful building cut out of sandstone in the side of the rock. Well, there's nothing in that place. There's just one empty room here and an empty room here, and it's not very big at all compared to the way that it looks in pictures. But the Bible says in 2 Chronicles that people will flee to Petra in order to be able to hide in the caves and to escape the wrath of the Antichrist when he begins to rule upon this earth. The old song says, where are you going to run? Where are you going to hide? You see, I thank God that as a Christian, I won't be here. Amen. If you're saved, you won't be here. But if you're not saved, you're going to have to endure all this. Because the word of the Lord says that there will be a mass exodus from Jerusalem and Judea, verse 16. Verse 17 says, homes will be no refuge. Look carefully. Let him which is on the housetop not come down. Take anything out. Right now, our homes are our refuge. Our home, we say today, we have a saying in our society today, a man's home is his castle. That's what we say. That's his place. That's his refuge. That's his security. But it'll be gone. Won't be there. All this that we build, all this that we do, all this that we anticipate, listen, the Bible says you leave and you won't even take a toothpick out of that house because you'll be getting away. Thirdly, a person will flee with simply what's on his back. Look at verse 18. Neither let him which is in the field return back to take his clothes. He won't take anything. He won't get an extra pair of shoes. He won't get anything. It'll be pandemonium. People will be leaving and trying to get out of the way. They just want to get themselves safe. We see that going on today in Iran, in Iraq, in southern Turkey. We see that in Afghanistan. We see that where those people, especially those who are Christians, are fleeing with absolutely nothing in order to be able to survive because they're Christians and will not embrace Islam. Islam is the most damnable thing that has happened in this world, and it's going to become a prevalent power in our society. And anybody who says Islam is a peaceful religion, they're just full of prunes, I can tell you that. This past week, one of the congressmen in South Texas was making this statement to Washington, D.C., and he said, do you realize how many prayer rugs we have found in the brush on the Mexican-Texas border, where these are not illegal immigrants in Mexico and Guatemala and El Salvador and all these places or South America. These are Arabs who are coming in through Mexico, and they had to leave in such a hurry from the Border Patrol that they left behind their prayer rug. But yet we say there's no problem on the border. I'm telling you today, we better wake up and smell the coffee, as we say. Because the truth is that if there's ever been a time when we ought to get closer to God and closer to his word, it's in the day and age in which you and I live. It's apparently right here before us. A person will flee with what's on his back. In verse 19, it says, desperation will exist between mothers and their babies in trying to supply for the needs of those babies. Nursing mothers will have nowhere to go. Babies will be put to death. The Antichrist will decide who's going to live or who's going to die. Hey, wake up again. Look at what ISIS is doing. Who are they slaughtering by the wholesale? Little children. Who are they killing? Babies. Cutting off their heads and putting them on a stick. To say to the people, if you will not embrace Islam, we're going to kill you. And they are. That's just a forerunner. Just a slight picture of what it's going to be like during the tribulation. When Christians are out of here and this world is left in the chaos and the confusion of the world. The final thing is that the elements and the law will come down upon the heads of those who are left behind. Look carefully, if you would, down there in verse 20. but pray ye that your flight be not in the winter, neither on the Sabbath day. Because the climatology of the world today, we got all these folks running around, global warming, global warming, global warming. Credible scientists who've lived a long time said, as long as they have records, the earth has had seasons of heat and seasons of cold. There have been cold winters and warm winters. There have been cool summers and hot summers. There have been high snowfall and high rain and seasons of drought and seasons of dryness as long as man has kept record. But today we say, well, because of global warming, we're having all these upheavals in the weather. Man designs his own philosophy to equip his own thinking and to draw others into his own demise. Because the power and the truth is that everything is in the hands of the Creator God. And He Himself has created us, not we ourselves. And if you jump on into these bandwagons, what you're doing is you're painting the deck of a sinking ship. And you're going to find out that all these philosophies of man are vain and ill-fixed. But if you hold to the Word of God and know what the Word of God says, the Bible said it'll be a lamp unto your feet and a light unto your path. And the more you get in the Bible, the more you're going to know what God wants and what God desires. And the more the Bible gets in you, the more it's going to change your life. It's the answer for every problem that you have. It is direction for everything that you need within your life. The swiftness of events will happen. You know, I hear people all the time say, well, one day I'm going to. No. Today is the day of salvation. One day I'm going to get better as a Christian. No, today is the day. Today is the day we ought to fill this altar and say, Lord, if there's anything between my soul and the Savior, I confess it, repent of it, forsake it, and ask you to fill me with your blessed, holy presence here today. The swiftness will come. Without time for preparation, the Jewish world will be smitten with the power of false religions and false Christ. And then finally, this will be the ushering in of the great tribulation. Look at verses 21 and 22. For then shall be the great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world, or beginning of time, or ever shall be. And except the days should be shortened, that no flesh should be saved, except for the elect's sake, the days will be shortened. Nothing compares to the horror. Nothing compares to the horror that lost men and lost women will face if they are not part of the rapture. I don't have words graphic enough to describe to you what's going to happen. We don't have a clue. We can look at the Holocaust back in World War II and we can say 6 million people put to death, starved to death. We've seen the pictures of those lined up being marched to the gas chambers. Bodies being hauled out on wagons and burned in the crematorium. We can look at those pictures of people whose legs were probably no bigger than my finger. They'd been starved to death and thrown in a pit, be covered up. But my friends, that is not a drop in the bucket compared to what it's going to be like during the time of the Great Tribulation. That's why, again and again, remember this is Jesus talking. He tells us, get ready. Don't put it off. Don't wait. Don't say one day. Today is the day to make that decision clearly before God. There's no measurement by which we can evaluate what's going to happen here. Verse 21 says, there's never been a time like this, never has been a time, never will be a time like this, because of the power of the Antichrist. Then thirdly, he reminds us the mercy of God is extended to those who will be saved. Who will be saved during the tribulation? Only two kinds of people will be saved during the tribulation. Romans chapter 11 says to us that the Jew will be saved. In fact, it says that when they realize this abomination of desolation, all Israel shall be saved and they will come before God for salvation. Now, those Jews who have died right now, never accepted Jesus, they're lost and in hell. Just like the Gentiles who died right now are lost in hell. But in that day, all the Jews will turn to God. The second group of people will be those who have never heard the gospel. Never heard the gospel. Never heard a Bible preacher. Never heard the truth of God's word. And when that comes, they will be lost. And they will be saved and they will turn to God. to the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, where does that leave those who've heard the gospel? Well, the Bible says in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 10, 11, 12, you better mark it down, that all those who've heard the gospel won't be saved. They'll never be saved. They've sinned away their day of grace, and there remaineth no more sacrifice for their sin, but a certain fearful looking to of the judgment of God. What does that mean? That means that we who are sitting right here in this room today, who have refused the Spirit of God, will never be saved. Read 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 10, 11, 12, and it says that they who refuse the truth will all be damned because they received not the truth but had pleasure in unrighteousness, and they will not be saved. There's no hope. So when this tribulation comes, there's no measurement which to value it. The mercy of God is extended. There will be those who will be saved. And God says, I'm going to shorten that period of time. Because if I didn't, they wouldn't be able to bear it, wouldn't be able to stand it, would not be enough. And except those days should be shortened, verse 22, there should no flesh be saved but for the elect's sake. I get amazed people today, well, the elect's sake. That means only a certain few is going to be saved. God's electing those. Let me tell you about election. I love what old Dr. B.R. Lakin used to say. He said, if you want to know the doctrine of election, this is it in a nutshell. God votes for you. The devil votes against you. You cast a decided vote. Now that's the doctrine of election. Because every man has the opportunity to be saved, and whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And it's your choice today. You see, nobody's going to take you by the neck and say, hey, you read your Bible this week? You study the Word of God this week? You get in Sunday school this week? You go to church this week? Nobody's going to do that. Because God created you with a free will to make a decision. And the choice is absolutely yours as to what you'll do with Christ, His Word, His church, and His salvation. Knowing that to be true, and understanding that to be true within our hearts and within our lives, what we need to do is to look around and see the world moving toward this time that is going to happen. Just look around. I'm telling you, if you just open your ears, open your eyes, open your mind to understand that at this time, all these things are just the tremors for the big earthquake that's on the way. They're just the warning blast that says, get ready, for Jesus is coming. They're just the call to all folks who sit in church benches on Sunday morning, dead to the world, and all they do is they come in and they pick up a bulletin, they sing a song, they hear a sermon, they get out and walk home. They can't even tell you what was about 10 minutes after they leave. Because their life is not injected with the purpose of Christ within their life. They want to live it to the max. They want to get out of here. Man, they got things they're going to do this week. They got things they're going to buy this week. They got places they're going to go this week. They got things that they're going to share this week. Where does Jesus fit into that? Look around. It's already happened. And then come to the vast conclusion. Number one, we need to look up and ask Jesus to live and to shine within our lives. Look around. See where you are. Then look up and say, Lord, if today is a day, are you pleased with me? What is it that is my God in my temple today? I'm asking you this morning. As the invitation is given, it's always threefold. Number one, if you are a Christian and you claim to know Jesus as your Savior, then what God is abiding inside of you today that's taking precedence over the Lord? You need to come this morning, get this altar, or sit here somewhere and renounce that stubborn will and come to Him. Secondly, you say, well, I'm a Christian, but I'm not a member of a church anywhere. Well, let me tell you, the doors of this church are open to welcome you and receive you. And now's the time for you to come. Unite in the family of God. because Christ loved the church and gave himself for it, and we ought to be a part of it. Thirdly, if you've never truly asked Christ in your heart, I don't mean you joined the church when you were a little boy, a little girl, you got baptized, then you've been living like the devil in the world ever since. But I'm asking you today, do you know that you know that you know that Jesus Christ is your Savior? What God guides your life today? What God is in authority with you this morning? Who rules and reigns within your heart and within your life? Look around. It's happening. Look around. In America this year, thousands upon thousands of abortions. And we put nice words on them. They terminated their pregnancy. Listen, folks, abortion is murder, is murder, is murder, is murder. Will God forgive that? Absolutely. 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 I say to every woman who's ever had an abortion, the Lord will forgive you and make you just as if you never sinned. But it's a sign of the times. What about euthanasia? Yeah. In some states, in the United States, it is legal today. If you're a person who becomes injured and can no longer function, and what they do is they just put you to sleep like you would a dog because you're no longer useful to society in that state. And we say, well, that is euthanasia. No, that's murder. That's murder. We got all kind of phrases that we gloss over and say, well, it's better to just let them. Listen, friends, God is the author and finisher of life and death. Who are we to make a choice of such sovereign proportions? Let God do it. God do it. The Bible says the Lord knows the length of your days. From the moment you were born, he knows how many heartbeats you've got left. Let God do it. It is God who's in charge. Amen? But you see, these things are happening because we're just warming up for the tribulation. And when the tribulation comes, no woman will be able to have a baby without the permission of Antichrist. And he's not going to give permission. He's going to abort everyone that gets pregnant, and he's going to make sure that they never bring an offspring into this world. He's going to eradicate all those who cannot function and who are sick. And he's going to do it in the name of economics, in the name of better welfare for the nation. And hey, you say that's so far-fetched. Let me tell you something. It's already in the workings in the United States of America today. With the health care incentives and programs that we've got in place in the United States, listen, it has already been planned in the belly of the Capitol in Washington, D.C., that pretty soon we will be able to eliminate any medical care for people over a certain age. And it will save us millions of dollars. The love of money is the root of all evil. And yet we don't take time to read and heed God's word. You better wake up. Yeah. You better wake up. Because tribulation truths show us where we are. So I ask you, you've never been saved, you don't know Jesus, come and accept him as your Savior today. Number two, you need a church home, the doors of this church are open to welcome you. You are a Christian, number three, and you've let some idol be built in your life. Oh, come to God today and say, search me, oh God. See what there is in my life. Come every soul by sin oppressed. There's mercy with the Lord. And he will surely give you rest by trusting in his word. Come then and join this holy band and on to glory good to dwell in that celestial land where joys immortal flow, where Jesus shed his precious blood, rich blessings to bestow. Plunge now into the crimson flood. Yeah. be made as white as snow. Choice is yours. The earth has already begun to shake and tremor. And it's going to be quicker than we can think. What will you do with Jesus? Look up and say, Lord, today, look at my life. Who's the real God of who I am? Amen. Let's pray. Father, we ask you in this moment, Lord, we prepare to sing this hymn of invitation, Only Trust Him. Only trust Him now. That we will not wait, we will not dilly-dally around. But even before we begin singing, that Christians will begin to flood this altar in prayer and bombarding heaven with spiritual desires to be closer and closer to you. God, in your power and in your promise today, that we would come and say, Lord, if there's some idol that's been built in my life, or several idols that are in my life, Lord, take them away, and you take the throne, and you be in charge. Lord, for those who need to come and join your family, for those who need to come and be saved, move in their hearts and their lives right now. Lord, we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Hymn number 317, as we stand, come on right now, as they begin to play. Playing. Don't wait. Come on and pray. This altar's open. God says now's the time. As they start to play, come on.
Washes white as snow. Only
make a decision for Christ this morning and you didn't do it, before you leave here today, come to me or someone and say, this is the decision I need to make. We should have done this. There's more than I should have done this. And follow through. Because there's another song that says, tomorrow's sun may never rise. And blessed by a long new sight. This is the time. Oh, then be wise. Be saved. Christian, lost person, plead the blood of Jesus for your life, because it is the blood that makes the difference. Father, I ask that you would touch our hearts today with your power divine, move in our soul, we ask it. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Would you join hands with those next to you? You know, I firmly believe what I said this morning. Suppose that God gave you the formula to cure cancer. And it was a very simple formula. And you know people who are dying with cancer. People that you love. Would you run to them and say, hey, God has given me the simple formula. And if you will do this, you'll be cancer free. I believe every person in front of them. Boy, you wear out shoe leather and tire and everything, you'll get the folks you know, wouldn't you? Let me ask you this. We've got a whole world riddled with cancer sin. And if you've been saved by the blood of Jesus, you know the simple formula. Are you wearing out to go to them? Because that's going to be eternal. And the only thing that can make a difference is the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Wash it white as snow. How about you today? Let us know if there's some decision you need.